Welcome to the Evergreen Indiana Introduction to Evergreen 2.7. To open, I'd like to share a permissions change approved in early December by the Executive Committee at the request of the Cataloging Committee. Beginning in 2015, Cat 1 catalogers are going to be required to complete refresher training annually to retain their Cat 1 status. This is in response to the many changes we have coming up with the RDA implementation and integration, as well as authority control and general policy changes. These new courses will be available as on-demand online classes and require 1 to 2 hours of your time to complete. They will be LEU eligible. The courses will be open for use in July, and you will have until the end of December to complete them. If you do not have an opportunity to complete a course by December 31st, your profile will be downgraded to Cat 2 until you do take the class. Additional information will be released by the Cataloging Committee as we move forward developing the class. This is our upgrade schedule. Our maintenance window will begin at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on December 23rd and close on the 28th. It is our hope that we will be back online well before the end of the day on the 28th, but to allow for unforeseen complications, we are going to leave the full maintenance window on the schedule. Libraries will be notified via the support listserv when server access resumes. I have spoken with Overdrive about the planned outage. Overdrive will be available as a standalone during the downtime, so if you are part of the EIDC group, you're all set. If you're a member of one of the other consortia, you may wish to confirm the standalone with your liaison. What this means for your patrons is that existing users will see no disruption in service during the downtime. New registrations will be on hold until the servers are again available, however. We will not be making any changes to the server IP, so you do not need to notify your SIP vendors unless you wish to arrange for standalone mode while the servers are unavailable during the maintenance window. The OPAC and search. 2.7 brings back meta record searching, which allows us to do grouped searches. This sample from the staff client is identical to the experience that the patron has in the web-based OPAC. There's a checkbox right here at the bottom of the search page. It is an optional setting, just like searching for available items, which must be selected each time you wish to group results. We've had such fun with the fault in our stars this year that I've selected it for some of today's demonstrations. If I search without selecting the Group Editions and Formats button, you can see that 2 pages of results are returned for 17 individual records. If I turn on the grouped search, the results are brought down to a much more compact 4 results. Here are the full results of the group search on the test server. This makes it much simpler for the patron to locate and place a hold on a title that may have a variety of editions available. These trainings include the draft icons based on the conceptual art of Quentin Edwards, a staff person at Evergreen Indiana Member Library, Danville Center Township Public Library, that we will be implementing over the next couple of months. Along with the new graphics, you will see new tags, which are much more comprehensible to the end users. Gone are the days of projected medium in favor of DVD, Blu-ray, or VHS. With the integration of grouped searching is the return of MetaHolds. Some of you may remember early implementations had a functioning MetaHold search, but the code was eventually deprecated and removed some time ago. We're delighted to bring it back to improve turnaround hold time on high-demand items which span multiple editions and formats. To place a MetaHold, compress standard search results using the grouping feature and click on the Place a Hold link in the grouped search. This will open up a page where the patron can select from a variety of available formats, books and large print books, DVD only, etc. Language options may also be selected. While not visible in this title's case, items with parts have an additional component to specify. The remainder of the holds interface is unchanged. If you are curious about the pool of resources appearing in a group, you can click through on the title. In the second record here, you can see that there are 12 records in this group across a variety of formats, and that will open up a list of all bib records from which a MetaHold may be sourced. In this excerpted example, you can see a variety of possible records from which a MetaHold may be generated. If you are concerned that an incorrect item may be targeted, you may wish to drill down and place a title level hold instead of a meta hold. If you notice an item that should not appear in a grouped list, please contact your cataloger. The cataloging committee will be working on recommendations on how to exclude materials from incorrect inclusion in groups. Groups are currently formed based on a fingerprint generated by normalizing and combining the tags 245 subfield A and 100 subfield A. So for everything in this example group, the title is The Fault in Our Stars and the author is given as John Green. This is an example from the client side when you search the catalog and bring up a list of item records. In 2.5, the barcode is an underlined link. If you click it, it opens up the item status page. That link is no longer available in 2.7. Instead, new links and link text have been provided. If you click on View, it will behave like the old link and open up the item status page. The other link is Edit. To date, if you needed to update an item, you needed to open up Holdings Maintenance and locate the item to make volume, part, or barcode edits. Yes, there are other methods as well, but that is one of the more common workflows. By clicking on the Edit link, you are now taken directly into the interface that allows you to update the call number, barcode, and/or part designation. And then it's one click to either finalize or take you over to item attributes so that you can edit that as well. Library information pages. Just a few months ago, we encouraged libraries to input their local URLs into their settings so that patrons could click on a link in the catalog and be taken directly to your homepage if they wish to find out more about your library. Not everyone chose to adopt this measure, so we had a mixture of links and plain text appearing in the catalog. In 2.7, you can see that everyone has a link, whether we have a local URL or not. What these new links do is provide the patron with a page that includes your contact information, hours, and a link out to your web page, if you provided one. If you are a branch library that doesn't currently automatically show your system name, you will also see a listing of the parent library system. This can be really helpful if you're working on transits and are trying to track down the parent system information for shipping. Patron side, there are a few changes to the My Account features. In My Lists, call numbers now are only local call numbers, so if your library does not own a copy, end users have a visual cue that they will need to obtain the item as a hold transit. There's also a fun new feature for capturing personal notes. In the provided example, you can see that the summer blockbuster of 2014 was The Fault in Our Stars. To edit or create notes, simply click on the Edit link. Boxes will open next to each listing. Enter your notes and click Save Notes. Ta-da! Personally relevant content has been captured and is available to refer back to. You can use this to capture book reviews, recommendations, gifts and memorial information. This content can be exported and used by the list creator as needed. Circulation. We can now extend a patron's expiry date with a single click inside the user edit interface. You should still confirm their contact information and eligibility before saving. Cataloging. We have some new wizards to assist with fixed fields, specifically with the type, language, bibliographic level, and form elements. These were chosen due to their importance for the new MVF icons. Other fields may receive similar assistance in later versions. To use them, simply right-click on the field and select your desired input from the list. The other new wizard is for the 007. The 007 is vital for the proper display of item format icons, so we are encouraging catalogers to update or include 007 tags on all eligible records. The 007 wizard is accessed by right-clicking in the 007 field and selecting the Physical Characteristics wizard. The wizard walks you through each step of creating or verifying the content of the 007 field. A question appears describing the type of entry for each field, and the drop-down list provides all valid entries. Click on Next to address each following field. Because many of the fields are dependent on earlier entries, the wizard does not allow you to jump to a single specific field. You must click Next until you reach the relevant field. Click on OK to finalize the tag entry. If you are unfamiliar with the 007 and its functionality, I would encourage you to take a look at the archived version of the 007 workshop that Sarah Childs presented last fall. Monographic parts merging. There are two aspects to monographic parts merging. First is merging parts on a single bibliographic record. In this example, there are two separate listings for parts for discs 1 and 2 of Downton Abbey Season 4. To merge them, go to the Monographic Parts Manager in the Actions for Record menu. Inside the Parts Manager, select the parts which you wish to merge. Please do take a moment to confirm that the parts do match fully before merging them by clicking in the leading box and then clicking on Merge Parts. That will open up this dialog. Select the record you wish to be the final existing part. The parts are now merged and holds will place correctly against the merged parts. There is a known issue in that the part tag does not show on items that have had their parts merged following the process shown here. If you merge duplicate bibliographic records, the parts now merge and appear correctly. Reports. We are very excited to see that reporting is finally starting to get some development. Up first is the transition of the Excel outputs from XLS to XLSX. This will allow you to run longer reports that exceed 64,000 lines of output. The reports portion of the interface has had multiple new functionalities implemented. To date, report entries have largely been placeholders. You could delete them or see that they were scheduled, but that was about it. Now we have two new links on each entry. The first is View. Viewing a report allows you to see exactly what your inputs, output settings, and template content were for an existing report. All inputs are grayed out and no changes can be made. This information can be immensely helpful if you are testing a new template and need to track your inputs from attempt to attempt. The second new link is Edit. Edit allows you to open up an existing report and make changes. You can edit your input selections, change the output formats, recurrence, who receives the output notice, and where the output is stored. There are two options then. First, you can save the report and that will overwrite the existing report. The second option is to save as new. This will allow you to create a duplicate version of the report that exists separately from your original report. This can be very useful if you need to create matching reports for individual departments that are otherwise identical. The last new feature is targeted at template writers, but I hope you will adopt this if you create templates to share. Field hints are intended to provide end users with guidance so that appropriate inputs are provided. Inside the template editor, the field hints appear here. Click on Change Field Hint to add or edit your support text. There's also a place just below the template description field, which allows you to link out to support documentation if you have a particularly complex template that you would like to provide step-by-step walkthroughs for. In the report creation process, end users will see your field hints appear here, right alongside the entry boxes. Administration. The BC Library Sitka Consortium up in Canada did the development on this next feature as a result of all of the development work they've done on acquisitions. One of the things they noticed was that due to the way permissions are siloed in Evergreen, staff were highly inconvenienced by having to switch back and forth and back and forth between profiles to complete their tasks. Staff now have the option of having secondary profiles. Local admins may add additional profiles as needed by clicking on this button, selecting a profile, then clicking Add. Repeat as necessary. This eliminates the need for users to have multiple working accounts or lots of special permissions. What this means is if you are a circulation staff member who occasionally needs to add holdings to the catalog, your Circ 1 or Circ 2 account may now have Cat 2 permissions assigned without a full second account. We believe this will be very useful in libraries where each staff person wears many hats. The interface has been rated AA compliant by WCAG, which means it is well optimized for visually impaired users. We are delighted to know that our catalog is as user-friendly as possible for all of our patrons. Thank you for joining me today, and I look forward to sharing the Evergreen adventure with you as we make the transition to 2.7.